So if you'll turn there with me. We're talking about verse 10 and the three separate things that were being mentioned here, the power of his resurrection, the fellowship of his sufferings, and the one that we didn't cover is the last one. They're being made conformable unto his death. The first one involved power, power of his resurrection. I'll just make this little statement. The power of resurrection is the depth of the death. I'm not going to elaborate. We have elaborated on that plenty of times. The second one is the fellowship of his sufferings. And we briefly mentioned to fellowship with the Lord. To have fellowship with the Lord. How many people really think in terms of fellowship in his sufferings? A lot of times we'll go to the Lord and we want him to fellowship in our sufferings. Well, you know, we go, Lord, I hurt myself. Come pet my flesh, you know. And that's understandable. The Lord cares, and the Lord does touch us. And, you know, we believe in healing, and we believe in all that is ours, bought and paid for by the atonement. Amen? But each in its own order, each according to its proper application. For example, it would be like, I'm just making something up here. It'd be like a child 3, 4, 5, 6 times in his life on his bicycle or on the swing and then falling off or something like that, scraping himself, bleeding, hurting himself, and always mom would come to the rescue with a Band-Aid. Put a Band-Aid on it, blow on it, kiss him, tell him it's going to be okay. And then one day he comes down with cancer and he goes to mom for a Band-Aid. Well, a Band-Aid will work, but for the right thing. Do you see what I'm saying? You know, an aspirin will work, but for the right thing. Okay? And we tend to fall into small categories of daily needs and not realize that there's something greater than even daily needs. There's eternal principle that could be at work, and God's trying to bring us into something greater. And I think some of our other scriptures will deal with that in a minute. So the fellowship of his sufferings, I mean, probably if this wasn't written here, I would have never have thought, Lord, I want to fellowship in your sufferings. You see what I'm saying? I don't think that ever would have come to mind. Is that your car, Deb? Nope. I would want to fellowship in his victories. You see what I mean? Isn't it funny that nowhere written in the New Testament does it say to fellowship in his victories? I'm just telling you, it's not. I mean, you check it out, but it's, you know, but it does say to fellowship in his sufferings, and that'll be mentioned in some of these other scriptures. So I'm not going to elaborate on that anymore. And then finally, just the last one. Being made conformable unto his death. Okay, so one is that he wants the power of his resurrection. The other one is that he wants to fellowship with the Lord in his sufferings. But one of them, the last one, is not fellowshipping. The last one is not getting some sort of a power. The last one is, I want to be made conformable to your death. God bless you. I wonder why a sneeze gets more blessings than a cough. You know, God bless you, you know. I think coughs are cheated personally, but that's neither here nor nothing spiritual about that. Be made. He wants to be made something now. The first two are not, he's just fellowshipping or he's just experiencing the power. But he wants to be made conformable to his death. Now, how many of you had ever thought of that just off the cuff? You know what? I want to be made conformable to his death. But Paul did. And we have many other scriptures that address that situation. But it certainly is a reality that not just Jesus died 2,000 years ago and that's it. And we just claim it, name it and claim it. Blab it and grab it. But what we do is now we want that cross that was 2,000 years ago to be something that we're conformed to. I mean, it's in the Word. And all the fighting and, you know, misunderstandings that we can have will do nothing. What we need to do is pursue what God meant when he had this written. All right. Enough said about that. But I mean, you just don't hear, you just don't go to churches and hear people say, you know what, folks, we need to be made conformable to Jesus' death. Basically, it's, you know, well, we need to believe what he did 2,000 years ago. Well, we do. We need to believe 2,000. But this is beyond that. This is having conformity to it now. All right, Paul didn't elaborate. He just made those statements and moved on. Why? Because God likes frustrating us with not telling us. No. No, he wants us to seek him out. He wants us to seek him to get this from God himself and not just from a book or from a man. All right, let's leave this now. And let's go to 2 Corinthians chapter 12. And we'll start at verse 7. All right, here's another one that'll just blow your mind if you're not careful. All right, this is Paul speaking. He says, lest I should be exalted above measure through the abundance of the revelations, there was given to me a thorn in the flesh, the messenger of Satan to buffet me, lest I should be exalted above measure. For this thing I besought the Lord thrice, that means three times, that he might depart from me, that it might depart from me. And he said unto me, my grace is sufficient for thee. For my strength is made perfect in weakness. All right. What are we dealing with here? Since when does God send a messenger of Satan? And yet the very reason why this messenger of Satan came was because Paul was having so many revelations and seeing things from God that it was starting to puff him up. Now here's where I had a problem with this. This was all the way back when I was in Bible school. I said, Lord, I thought seeing Jesus would conform us to his image to such a degree that we wouldn't have these problems. Well, he didn't answer this way, but he could well have said, well, just read the Bible. What does it say right there? Well, I guess it can happen, and it doesn't matter what I think. Also, I didn't think that, I looked at it like, oh, there's God and the devil, you know. And God's trying to, you know, there's this war going on, and God's trying to defeat the devil. And the devil's trying to defeat God, and that's this big war going on. One day it came to me that God is not a created being. God is God, and the devil is a fallen angel, a created being. And if God wanted to destroy him, just literally go, Satan, and it just, he's a grease spot. He could do that because he's God. And then the thought came to me, if this is a power struggle, why is God getting in the middle of it? There is, in this corner, God, and over here, a fallen angel. You know, I mean, it don't look like it's going to turn out good to me if it's a power struggle. But it's not a power struggle. There is an eternal plan. There's an eternal purpose going on, and God wants that purpose to be Christ formed in us, and these scriptures are going to prove it in just a second. That he wants more than just people delivered from every problem. Well, I mean, I'm glad y'all know that. I didn't. You know, I'm glad y'all can amen. Because it was like, what? You know? And then I realized that Satan was a tool in the hands of God. You know, I mean, the scripture says all things work together for good, and that good is that we be conformed to the image of his son. All things work together for good to them that love God, who are called to according to his purpose. And to use the word all things means everything. Satan, you know, God, a car wreck, this or that, all that. I mean, that it is all working not good in our lives so that our lives will be good. It is all working that we be conformed to the image of his son. Verse 29. All right. So in that, I had to start readjusting. I had to start giving up my doctrine, the doctrine that I'd learned over many years from many preachers and whatever. And I had to start saying, I'm running across a lot of stuff that seems contrary to some of the things I've been taught. And if this is God's doctrine, then I don't want my doctrine to be my own. I want it to be his. So Lord, you know, what I did was kind of like, there's this altar, here's God. And I laid all of the doctrines and all the teachings out, and I said, pick and choose. Deal with whatever you want. Most of us don't do that, so he doesn't, you know, because he's a lamb and the Holy Spirit's a dove, so he's not going to go, here, give me that. Your life's a mess. You know, he waits for us to open up and say, look, you're Lord, you're Father, you're my Father, you know best. I don't know what's going on here, okay? You know, and he starts going, okay, well, you see this? Let's get rid of it. And he's going to give us his heart. You understand? I mean, that's the good thing about it, is we're not just going to get a replaced doctrine. He's going to tell us what's in his heart and what he had in mind from the very beginning. And that, my friends, is worth everything. Because now you're in touch with his heart, you're finding out from his mouth, and you're getting, then the scriptures are starting to make sense, because they're all one, they all were birthed in his heart. So we go, oh, I'm going to know the scriptures, and then I'm going to know everything. No, you learn the scriptures, and then you ask the Holy Spirit to show God's heart, where it came from. And then you go, plop, okay, I don't just want ink on white paper, Lord. I want to see into your heart. And he goes, wow, I don't get that very often. Sure, I'd be glad to do that. You know what I mean? I'd be glad to do that. Because he wants that. All right, so so Paul in 2 Corinthians 12, verse 9, he seeks the Lord. Lord, this is the devil. I mean, you can read it right there. He's basically saying, this is the devil. This can't be you. And the Lord would probably say something like, yeah, you're right. I'm not the devil, but I can use the devil. All right, so I mean, Paul's wrestling here. You know, he in the next few verses, he comes clear. But right here, he's wrestling exactly the way I was wrestling. How, Lord, how could you use the devil? How could, why, you know, everything I'd been taught is, you know, we don't want the devil in any way, shape, or form. Well, I don't. I want the Lord. But I don't care what method he has to use. If I'm being puffed up, I am not conforming to the image of Christ. I'm becoming something that God hates and I'll eventually hate. So, you know, the old thing, Lord, do what you got to do. Can I send Satan? Nope. But the answer isn't, he wouldn't say, can I send Satan? He would say, can I use whatever tools I need to conform you to the image of my son? And our goal usually in these things is to run away, is to get free, to run. I just want to be free. As long as you're running with you can't run far enough from you. You know, I mean, you're the problem. Satan isn't the problem. He could, you know, the scriptures say, I am crucified with Christ, right? Galatians 2:20, I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live, yet not I, Christ liveth in me. Okay, the scriptures never say, I crucified the devil. Did you ever read in the book of Revelation where he takes the devil and he throws him in the lake of fire? Is that it, or the thank you, absolute bottomless pit, and puts a chain on it and locks him up for 1,000 years. Anybody hear that? And so then, after 1,000 years, God goes and lets him out. You're going, what the heck are you doing? Give me that key. You know, you clearly don't know what you're doing. And then what happens? The devil ends up with this big army that comes against God again. You're going, where'd this big army come from? This is supposed to be the cleansed group. So wherein lies the problem then? Us. We're still open to something. And guess what? We may not be saying, you know, I am open to the devil. We would say, I want my way. You know, I want my way. The devil says, well, I can fix that for you. Yeah. You know, you go, really? Because I was talking to Jesus and he wasn't going to fix it. You know, well, no, he's not going to fix it. Not in that way. Not for you. Not for you. You're his enemy when you act like that. You understand what I'm saying? You've got the very thing that he died on the cross for. You're living according to that. And he's saying, you know, what you need to do is go to that altar and quit trying to hide things. You know, we say, oh, I'm going to lay everything on the altar. Here's this, this, and this, and this. And we slide something up our sleeve, you know. And the Lord goes, is that it? And we go, yeah, that's it. You know, what's that big clump in your sleeve? You know? Oh, I kind of hurt myself, yes. A little bit swollen. You don't think he knows? Come on, he knows. But more importantly, he's not looking at you and going, you're an idiot. You know, I know what's there, and I know what you're doing. When I say he knows our frame, he knows all of that stuff, but he also knows what he has fed us up to that point. You know, I've used this, I've mentioned this recently, but, you know, the Psalm 23, it says that he leads us beside the still water, he leads us into green pastures. He does all of that before he leads us into the valley of the shadow of death. He prepares us for those things. But our problem is that we forget everything that we learned before we get there, and we take two or three steps into the valley of the shadow of death, and we want him to manifest a green pasture right in the middle of that dark valley. Oh, Lord, you said you would, you know, and all this kind of stuff. And he's going, where's the green pasture? Where's the still waters? This is scary. He's saying, it's supposed to be in you. I've already led you. You ate those green pastures. You drank those still waters. They're not out there. It's not an external that's going to save you. You're supposed to be, can I say it? Saved. And what I mean is not saved from hell or whatever, but you're saved by the green pastures that you've already been eating and by the still waters. And those things are your sustenance and they are your being. You have taken them into your being and they have become part of who you are. And you get in there and you're not looking for still waters and green pastures in the valley of the shadow of death. Not out. Not externally. it's out of your innermost being shall flow rivers. Okay. Well, the natural reaction, you see it in Paul. Is that comforting? He prays three times, Lord, get this devil out of my life. I was happy before this. I was seeing all sorts of revelations. I was knowing you. That was the promised land. That was the beauty. That was the that was when I was dwelling in, you know, nirvana. You know, just the most beautiful place. And he would say, you are wrong, and you're wrong in your view, and everything about that is wrong. Nirvana is Christ. It is him dwelling in you. It is him inhabiting. It is him taking over your fears, taking over your things that you're grasping after and going, you know. And even that, sitting in that beautiful place with all those revelations before before Satan has come, the messenger of Satan to buffet you, sitting there in that beautiful place, the Father knows that you're seeing, you're hearing, it's great stuff, but it's not Christ formed in you. Remember what he said in Galatians 4:19? Paul prayed for the church. I am in travail. This isn't no small thing. I'm in travail until Christ be formed in you. Not, you know, and he's talking to Christian people. They have Christ. You know what I mean? We have Christ. But we're believing that his goal is revelation instead of unveiling Christ. The word revelation means unveiling. We just want revelation instead of Christ unveiled. But if Christ is unveiled, guess who decreases and guess who increases? And if it's going to be an increase of Christ, it's going to be a decrease of us. And if it's going to be a decrease of us, we have to see that properly and in the right spirit. And to see that properly and in the right spirit is to see not that I'm going to decrease in all the things that I really want. And God, why can't I have this? And why can't you take this away so I can have this and all this stuff? Instead, it's not that at all. That's the wrong view of decrease. It is make more room for Jesus. That's decrease. Make more room for Jesus. Well, that's not going to come out of you naturally unless your heart's right. If your heart's not right, you're going to hate decrease. And you're not even going to be thinking about an increase of Christ. All you'll think about is what you're going to lose. That's what people, you know, I remember when we used to go down to Mardi Gras, I made a track and wrote it, and the front of it, you know, we'd hand it to somebody, and it says, what do I have to give up to follow Jesus? And you open it up and it says, hell. You know, just very simple. Oh, because they're expecting, well, you're going to have to give up this, and you're going to have to give up that, and da-da-da-da, and all this kind of stuff. Well, when you see correctly, the truth is you want him so much that you're not aware. I mean, it's like he's filling, and there's no void. He's filling, you know, where there's a decrease with you, you're not empty. You're being filled with Christ. We were talking about this Sunday morning. This thing of my wording at first, the first sentence I said when I said it was that we've become hard-hearted. And then I said, you know, no, that's not right. Cold. Our heart becomes cold towards the Lord. And in this picture that I'm using right here, here's how you can weigh true coldness of heart. And that is when you don't want to decrease, which would mean a true increase of Christ. Your heart is cold towards the Lord. And when it's cold, it's wanting its way. Whatever that means. Who knows? You know what I mean? Who knows what that means? You know what that means. Better than I do. I mean, because it's different for everybody. That's what I'm trying to say. And so A cold heart is simply we're cold-hearted towards the Lord. Oh, I don't really, you know. See, we would never say, because we would not say, I don't want an increase of you, Jesus. We couldn't look into his face and say that, because that's not really our motive. It's you still get the same result, but that's not our motive. Our motive is, I don't want to decrease. You see what I mean? It's not, you know, you're not Antichrist. You're pro Randy or whatever, you know, pro self, you know. And so all that means is that your heart has grown cold toward, you know, how did it say in the book of Revelation? You've lost your first love. You've lost your first love. And so he's still being robbed of it being the increase. But maybe we don't feel quite as bad because we're not rejecting him. We're just promoting self. But because we won't decrease, he can't increase. All right. So Paul's in the throes of this. He's facing it. He faced all the same junk. You know, we always think that we're the only one going through it. It reminds me of when I was a missionary in Jamaica. We lived up on top of this hill, and of course it's tropical, and it's a tropical island, and it has monsoon seasons and everything, and I mean everything constantly grows. It's insane how quickly it grows. So you always carry a machete around with you, and I would have to go down the hill and turn the water on so it would pump up to the tank so that we'd have water up on the property. And to get down there, I would have to hack my way all the way down and hack my way all the way back. You always carried a machete with you, because if you didn't, the place would just overgrow. It was that bad. I mean, it was that. So they'd have it. So when we got there, there had been other missionaries who had been there, and they had done the same thing. But they said, okay, Randy, you need to get you a machete. So I bought me a machete, and they said, okay. And they point on this little path. You can barely see that there was a path there. And they say, okay, you're going to have to cut your way all the way down to the bottom of this and flip the switch and pump this stuff up to the top, pump the water up to the top. Okay. So I'm cutting, and I'm thinking, am I the only one who's ever been down this path? I mean, really, I'm genuinely thinking, this is crazy. I'm the only one. I'm all by myself. And there had been probably hundreds of people who had cut their way down that path before. Well, that's the way we feel. Sometimes we feel like I'm the only one that's on this path. But let me tell you, for every, I'll just say it like this, and this isn't really accurate, but for every brother or sister that failed because they didn't want to decrease, therefore they never had that increase, there's one that did go down that path. They did go down. They took the path, and they cut their way through it, and they cut their way back, and they didn't say, well, why didn't somebody go before me and do this? You know what I mean? They did. There are people who've gone before you, and they've successfully made it. You know what I mean? And what was it called as in Hebrew? Called those pioneers of the heavenly way? Yeah. Woo! Yeah. Well, and of course it's all glory, because when as it were, once you cut your way through and you've done it, there's an increase of Christ, a genuine increase of Christ, because there is no increase of Christ through prayer, just reading the Bible. Did you know that? There can only be the information. What you do with it determines whether it's going to be him or it's going to be you. That's all up to you, your will and your desires, what you want to put first. All right, so he prays three times, get me out of this. And the Lord answers him. The first part is, my grace is sufficient for thee. Okay, and if that was all I heard, I would kind of go, no, you wouldn't, but I would kind of go, well, I don't think it is. because this seems pretty hard. But his point wasn't grace is sufficient. Hey, we didn't finish the sentence. The point is, for my strength is made perfect in weakness. So the end of verse 10 says, for when I am weak, then am I strong. And it says, let's see, I don't even have it marked here, but it says that his strength is made perfect in my weakness. All right, my God, folks, that's a revelation. His strength is made perfect in my weakness? I mean, that goes against a whole lot of doctrines I was taught. I was taught the whole point is we're all supposed to be getting stronger and stronger and stronger. We're all supposed to be becoming stronger. And Paul is saying, no, we're supposed to be becoming weaker so Christ can be our strength. He didn't say so Christ can give us. He didn't say so Christ could give us strength. He said so Christ could be our strength. That's an improvement if you think about it. It's an improvement over God strengthening me, because what does it say in the Psalms? Man at his best is altogether vanity. That's a great scripture. I don't know how many of us believe that. And maybe we believe it about everybody else, but don't believe it about ourselves. You know. But the truth is, Paul started embracing, you can see it in the last scriptures that we read, and you can see it in Galatians 2:20, and you can see it in, Colossians 1:27. You can see it all over the place where his doctrine is starting to change. It's no longer his own doctrine. This is God's doctrine, and God's doctrine to Paul is, here's what he's replacing, and here's what he's gaining from God. He's replacing a doctrine that says, God wants me spiritual, God wants me strong, God wants me better. All right, and can you see that? It's kind of like in a boat out in the middle of the ocean, he's starting to throw some of this stuff out. And he's gaining God's doctrine, which says, Christ in you, the hope of glory. I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live, but not I. Christ liveth in me. In Hebrews? That we might be partakers of his holiness. Not just holiness. It's a partaking of him through us in that term. John 15, I am the vine, you are the branches, that my joy may be in you, instead of just being joyful Christians. In other words, every ounce of this is a increase of Christ in us, in a real way. You know, not a bunch of doctrines about it. This is God's reality taking over a man, taking over his heart, and transforming him into the image of Christ. Not that he's becoming Christ, but Christ is being formed in him. And he's embracing not just a decrease, but a death that brings decrease. I am crucified with Christ. All right. Scriptures are full of that. Now, most people haven't seen it. All they got to do is read their Bible. It's just full. So, all right. Now, here's the kicker. Here is the kicker, and here is, again, our question. What I'm about to read, is this your basic doctrine and how you view troubles, trials, problems, situations, the moment they arise? Okay, and that's the second part of verse 9. Most gladly, therefore, will I rather glory in my infirmities, that the power of Christ may rest upon me. Therefore, I take pleasure in infirmities, in reproaches, in necessities, in persecutions, in distresses for Christ's sake, for when I am weak, then am I strong. Now, how many of you genuinely can say, that's me right there, all right, that's the way I live? Well, if we're truthful, that's contrary to the human mind. That's contrary to the human constitution. We will not want that unless God does a work in us. And we're going to have to view it like last class. We're going to have to view it from the asparagus viewpoint. Remember? We're going to have to not go with let me give you an example of something. One time there was something that I really wanted, and it was my flesh, and I just thought, you know, this would this would make me happy. Okay. And so, but it was one of those deals that, you know, it's like, okay, if I take this road, I'm going to lose everything that I hold dear. I will never be able to talk about the cross again because I'm violent. I'll never be able to talk about the body of Christ because I'm violent. I'll never be, just right down the line, everything that I had been raised on and fed and brought to this crossroads meant either I choose Jesus and that is no longer any sort of a thing, or I choose that thing and the Jesus that I know could not possibly exist in that kind of environment. It's kind of like a terrarium for lizards instead of Christ. Oh my God. I wrestled and I went through stuff and I just, you know, and I refused to let my love for Jesus drown. But at the same time, all that did was add to the agony. Oh God. Finally, one day I said, Lord, I want you, and I want you more than anything else in the world, but I'm going to ask you, because all I saw was a crossroads, two things. I'm going to ask you if there's any way that I couldn't have a clue or something where it, you could make it Christ in me without violating anything. Then I just said, I don't see everything and I don't know everything. And the example the Lord gave me, you know, years ago was, you know, you could have something go wrong in your car. And you could have one specific problem and fix it any number of ways. I mean, you could go buy a new hose, you could get duct tape and wrap it, you could use bubble gum. There's any, you know, thank God for baling wire, you know, something. But that our ways are so narrow and therefore so wrong that if we're not careful, both ways are wrong. I won't try to explain that. I'm just saying, if we're not really seeing the Lord and right with the Lord, then we may be choosing the law instead of Christ, or we may be, anyway. And after a good long period of time of just waiting and going, you know, I don't know, I'm not going to do anything until you talk, because I'll mess this up royal either way. I just will. He came to me like a father to his son, and he sat down with me, and he began to explain something to me. And in his explanation, it was neither road, and it was so above everything that I just went, I could not believe it. It was pure Christ. And it was like, see, it didn't answer either one of the crossroads. It brought me above to something that was so liberating, and yet so pure. And saying all of that doesn't really give you any explanations of anything other than to say, you know, don't give your heart up for the Lord. Trust that he sees beyond and that he can do stuff you couldn't even imagine, you know. And I'll just say this, and I do realize that in saying what I've said, I could have armed some people with justification for, you know, oh good, there is a way to totally satisfy my flesh. That's not what happened. It's not what happened. But it was so much above my flesh and everything that it was incredible. That's all I can say. It was Michelangelo-ish. It was like, oh my God. And you know, me and Deb have been to the Sistine Chapel and oh my God. It's just like, you know, Lord, this is incredible. And to me, to this day, I just am in awe. But a huge part of it for me was that I loved the Lord so much, I didn't want to give him up, but I believed that he surely saw things in a different light and higher than what I see things. And, you know, that's why we call him Father. Can I get amen? Yeah. That's why we call him Father, because he does, and Lord. And to not let anything ever take Jesus from me. And that was that thing of saying, okay, I'm just not going to do anything. I'm going to wait until he comes. And there was a good long wait. Some of the other scriptures we're going to deal with, we'll probably never get to the book. It'll probably be on these 8 scriptures that we have, right? But are y'all enjoying the class? Is this hitting home on some fronts? All right. So Paul uses this outrageous, and I mean outrageous. Now, you're not going to say what Paul says unless you're brought into what Paul was brought into. Okay, are you all right with that? Your flesh is going to rebel against such crazy statements, but your spirit can still say, I don't know what that means, but it's in the Word of God, and Lord, I want it if it's you. Can you agree with that? That's, you know, don't just reject it, you know what I mean? I mean, I love how Mary, the mother of Jesus, said, you're gonna bring forth Jesus. Well, that's like saying Christ is going to come out of you or me, and we go, well, how's he going to do that? I'm a mess. You know what I mean? Well, she didn't say, well, how is that going to happen? I'm a mess. It says she pondered these things in her heart. You know, don't embrace everything you hear, or don't think that I'm saying if you disagree with something, embrace it anyway. I'm not. I'm saying ponder it. And let the Lord breathe life, if there's life to be breathed into it. And if it's not, then just forget what I say. I'm an idiot. I'm the first one to admit it, okay? Don't listen to an idiot, okay? All right. Most gladly is the word he uses. Most gladly, therefore, will I rather glory in my infirmities that the power of Christ may rest upon me. Okay. So this is above getting your way, and it's above just embracing Christ in the manner that you already know him. This is gaining Christ beyond what Paul knew to this point. Do you see it? I mean, that's why there's all this reaction that he was having. This is gaining Christ, but it's gaining Christ beyond the measure or the crossroad that we think. It's saying there must be more, there must be higher. Why would a messenger of Satan be hitting me? What is going on here? I'm praying, you're not answering. You know? I mean, I remember one time I had a situation where I was praying, you know, I prayed 3 or 4 times. And I said, Lord, why are you not answering my prayers? And he said, I did answer your prayer. I said, what is it? And he said, no. Oh, okay. Sorry, I guess I didn't get the message. All right. Therefore, well, first of all, he's talking about accepting weaknesses and frailties and necessities and all this stuff, and he's doing it with purpose. Deb and I talked with somebody, or she talked with somebody recently that's no longer a member of our church, and he said to her, well, there's something I don't agree with that y'all teach at the church. She said, what's that? He said, Well, that y'all believe that we ought to suffer all the time.
Suffer, you have to suffer to get close.
Oh, you have to suffer to get close to Jesus. I don't believe you have to suffer to get close to Jesus. I don't. I don't believe that suffering is in any measure based on getting close to Jesus. I believe that if you come into fellowship with his sufferings, you can't fellowship with somebody unless you've been through what they've been through. Okay? So it's not the same thing. And I know what he's saying, but that's not what I'm doing. And so what does that tell me? It tells me I can stand up here all day and say the right thing, and if someone hears it wrong, they're going to hear it wrong. Well, I mean, I can't magically go, this is it, everybody see it, you know. And, you know, I mean, I think of Jesus hanging on the cross, and on one side he's got a thief, and the other side he's got a thief. And one of the thieves says, you know, he starts blaspheming Jesus. Blaspheming Jesus. Okay, now I can see somebody down on the ground standing up there going, well, you're an idiot, you ain't God, da 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 da. You know what I mean? I can see that because, you know, Jesus can't reach down and slap him. He's got his hands nailed up there or kick him in the face. You know, his feet are nailed, you know, headbutt him. You know what I mean? He's got a crown. He can't do any of that. So any bully would stand at the foot of the cross and go, you know, hey, and blaspheme him. This guy is going to die soon on the cross, on his cross. The guy saying, blaspheming Jesus. In just as short a time, he's facing eternity, and his last hurrah is to blame somebody else and not take anything on himself. You know, like, you're an idiot, you're this and that and all this stuff. And the other guy says, you know, shut up, leave him alone. He didn't do anything, but we did, we deserve this. But the fact that someone would be hanging on a cross beside him, and instead of, you know, I mean, if nothing else, just shut up. Well, what does that tell you? What does that tell me? It tells me that there are going to be people who won't see Jesus in me. There are going to be people who won't believe the truth of the cross, and they'll think that I'm perverting it and making everybody go through junk. Well, the name of this class is Troubles and Trials, Stumbling Blocks, or Stepping Stones. I assure you that the end goal of this is not that necessarily we get out of everything, but that everything we go through can be a stepping stone unto something greater in the Lord. Wouldn't that be okay? You know, and so the same is true for you. I mean, there are going to be people who don't believe you, don't like you. They won't even have any reason why they want to rage against you. They'll just think, you know, but you know what? They can think whatever they want to think. Your heart, Paul's heart, my heart, we're going to go after the Lord. And people can say what they want, and they can attack, and they can do whatever, but we're going to find Jesus not because we're worthy, but because we're just not going to give up. We may be buffeted. We may be, you know, rejected. There may be people who think that, I mean, right here within our own fellowship, people that don't like what we say or whatever, you know, they're not, you know, I mean, y'all are new here. Sure enough, there's going to be somebody who doesn't like you here. What are you going to do? You know what I mean? Well, if God, there you go. I like that. Because that's Christ. You know what I mean? But the point is, we face that somewhere, everywhere, pretty much, that we go. You know, there's no place perfect or whatever. But if, let's just put it on this basis, but if we can get Jesus here, then it doesn't matter what's going on here, you know. I mean, it's almost time to end, so I'll just end with this picture. When I was in Bible school, actually, I think I'd graduated and was still there before I went to the mission field, and somebody came up to me
And they said, they were talking about all the leadership of the church that I was part of that also had this Bible school. And they were just pointing out all the wrongs of the different people, particularly among the leadership. And I one of the first things I did was I said, well, I know there are problems here. They're trying to sway me, you know what I mean? I said, look, I know there are problems here. But I said, let's just take this from another viewpoint. I said, let's act like we're on the outside, little bit edge of the group that's following Jesus. Okay, so here goes Jesus. He's walking down the road to Galilee or in Jerusalem or something, and he's got Peter and James and John and Judas, and he's got all these guys walking along with him. So we're kind of on the edge of the group, you know, just watching because we're not sure about this little thing, you know. And so as they're following Jesus, we look over and we notice Judas looking around like this, and he reaches in and he takes some of the money out of the bag and he sticks it in his pocket. Because it says that. It does say that. Judas was stealing money out of the bag. Okay? I mean, Jesus is so dumb, he should have known he'd do that. Jesus did know that he would do that. He's not trying to prevent everything from being wrong. But anyway, that's not my point. So they're walking along. Of course, when they see that, they go, look at that. Oh, my God. These people are thieves. You know what I mean? And then after a while, they see James and John and his mother come up and say, hey, could my son sit on your right hand and on your left in the kingdom? I want them to be on thrones on either side of you. And they go, oh, look at the covetousness and the self-glorying and all this stuff. Oh, my God, you know? And then later on, they see Peter and he's, you know, I'll die for you. And then very shortly after that, you know, he's denying Jesus. I don't even know the man. And says he cursed and all this stuff. Hey, guys, they claim that they're committed and stuff. And then when it comes right down to it, they curse him and everything. Well, and then finally these two guys look at one another and say, let's get out of here. But folks, you're not supposed to be following Judas or Peter or James and John. You're supposed to be in the group following Jesus. You're supposed to keep your eyes on Jesus. That's who your Lord is. That's who the one is that counts everything. And Jesus gathered those people, didn't he? Didn't he? And we can see all those faults and we can say, well, this is wrong. They're wrong, but Jesus isn't wrong. And are you going to walk off and no longer follow Jesus because you saw a bunch of people doing junk? You know what I mean? You're going to see that anywhere, everywhere. But your commitment is supposed to be to Jesus. And that's what I told this guy that was talking about the leadership and stuff. I said, look, did God send you here? Yeah. Did God tell you to go? Well, yeah, all this is wrong. And I said, oh, so he said, leave this place. He said, well, no, but, you know, he let me see all this stuff. I said, I'm sure you would have saw it if you were with the original disciples. And when you said, well, I'm leaving this group, I'm going to tell Jesus, Jesus would have said, take up your cross, follow me, deny yourself. Well, what about them? I'm not talking to them. I'm talking to you. I love you. You're wanting to know my opinion? Here's my opinion for you. Well, you know, what about them? I tell them the same thing. We're all in the same boat. We all need to grow up. We all need more of the one we're following. We're not going to get more of Jesus by looking at everybody else. The only way there's going to be an increase of Christ is when we look into his face, we are changed into that same image from glory to glory. I need to get my eyes off of others, and I need to get my eyes onto Jesus. Now, this is I'm ending this. How long will what I just said last?
Forever.
Dreamer. Some of you will have a cross built for me out there in 2 weeks. No, the truth is, what I just shared should never leave your mind. It's in the Word. I mean, in the sense of all those things did happen. And we can see them. And we could say, well, if following Jesus means this, following Jesus doesn't mean that. Following Jesus means you lay down your life. And if you see it that way, then, I know I need to quit, but my wife and I were in a group once where there was plenty of bad stuff going on. And we would sort of get filled up to here. And so we, you know, one week she'd come to me and go, you know, we got to get out of this God-forsaken place. And I would say, Lord hadn't say go. And then about a week later, I'd come to her and go, you're right, let's get out of this place. And she'd go, Lord hadn't said no. I mean, thank God, you know what I mean? Good balance there. And that went on a couple of years, actually. Because the Lord told me at a certain juncture that parable of Jesus. And he said, the guy said, you know, should I cut it down? And the Lord said to him, dig around it, put fertilizer around the plant, and give it a couple of years. And if it doesn't do anything, then cut it down. Okay. So the Lord told me that. And what he meant by that was he was saying to me, Randy, do everything you know to do to make this thing healthy. Dig around it, fertilize it. You see what I mean? And that was the last thing I wanted to do. Do you understand what I'm saying? I mean, I wanted to pull out a Bowie knife and go, you know. But the Lord had other things in mind. You know, he's of another spirit. And so he said, basically, now he didn't say this, but he was implying this. If you can't give everything you can to make this thing come alive, then there's something wrong with you, not it. You know. Okay, so I said, yes, Lord. And I did. And I gave myself to that. And I mean, I was foremost in that fellowship of trying to make everything fly and work and be blessed and bring the Lord and do all this stuff. I mean, that just over and over and over again. And then at the end of 2 years, about 2 years and 5 minutes, I said, okay, Lord. It looks pretty much the same to me, only it's gotten worse, you know. He said, well, be patient. Keep doing what you're doing. And we did, and it ended up going several months. And the frustration built because we were ready to go. Anybody know what I'm talking about? And then one day, he said to me and Deb, totally apart, he said, okay, I'm done with you here. I want you to follow me. He didn't say leave. He said, never leave a place, always go after me. That's what he said. And that's good advice, isn't it? Never leave, I'm out of here, or that's wrong, and you're pointing, you know what I mean? Never leave anything. Find Jesus and go after him. And it worked. He did that. He actually did it. That's where this place came from. And that was 35 years ago or so. Long time ago. So, our heart. It's a heart thing. It's a heart thing. And the heart has to be after the Lord. And when it's after the Lord, then all of those things, they're in the hands of the Lord. They're in nail-scarred hands. And the proof that he bore, you know what I mean? They're not just in God hands. They're in nail-scarred hands. Every time I would, you know, I'd go, you know, well, I'm putting this in your hands. He'd reach out his hands, and I'd go, nail-scarred hands, okay, I need to die. You know, I need to lay down my life. I'm sorry, you know. If they'd just been clean, healed hands, I'd probably go, oh, I put this in God's hands. Praise God. God has it now. No effect, you know what I mean? But those nail-scarred hands would bring me to my knees every time. All right, let's pray. Father, we just come to you now, and Lord, you said in the multitudes of words there is sin. Lord, I'm sure so much that I say falls so short of truly bringing forth Christ. But Lord, I ask you that if anything, if any seed, any, even just one sentence can be breathed on by the Holy Spirit, that you would break that bread to your people here, that you would break that bread to your people that are here and on Skype and that may listen to this later or watch a DVD later, that there are those who would gain eternal insight into your ways based on your life, that we may walk in newness of life, your life. So we tell you, Lord, we give you our heart. We want you to draw us more to you and get our eyes off of the sin and the problems and the failures, and to find you in the midst of a crooked and perverse generation, to find you. You are here. You're in us. You're not just among us. You are our life. We won't do that, Lord. We can't do it. We're incapable. But you are, to renew our minds and to breathe the breath of life. So we love you. We love you so much, Jesus. We love you, Holy Spirit. Please continue to stir us up in these directions. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you. Folks, we're dismissed.